My name is Mark Breitenberg. I'm the Special Assistant to the President here at ArtCenter. And I was, until 2011, the President of the International Council of Societies of Industrial Design, which is the worldwide design organization. I mention that only because Dieter Rams has been a very active member of that organization for many years. And this is how we became friends.
And I'm Karen Hoffman. I'm the chair of product design here at ArtCenter and very honored to be part of this conversation today. Dieter, thank you so much for the visit and all the conversations that we've had so far. We're looking forward to continuing our conversation today.
So we're going to, Karen and I are going to ask a few questions and just to get things started. And then we'd really like to hear from all of you. This is really an opportunity for you to ask questions. I will not do an introduction of Herr Rams, because I'm sure that's completely unnecessary. He is, of course, arguably the most influential designer today in the world, whose work at Brown was influential for generations to come, including many designers today. So I'll start my first question by reminding everyone of the great tribute that Jonathan Ive gave to you in his design of the iconic Apple products. This has very much apparent in the recent exhibition of Dieter Rams' work that showed Dieter Rams' products next to those designed by Jonathan Ive. But you said something very interesting. You said, Apple has achieved something I never did.
That's right.
Can you explain that?
I was nearby, but I was the only one in the 60s, in the 50s, who, as a designer, reporting directly to the top of the to the entrepreneur at this time, it was the Brothers Brown. And later, I had the chance, as she led by the company Brown, always to reporting directly to the chairman of the board. And that was not normal at this time. And now I'm really very surprised that Jonathan Ives is not only, but the connect, what I think it's so necessary to have this close connection to the entrepreneur as a designer, as Jonathan Ives has it now with Apple. And now, after he died,
Steve Jobs,
he died shortly. I thought I could have met him. I was in San Francisco at this time. I had this exhibition there, and I was, of course, invited to come into the design department, but Steve Jobs was already ill, and I was back to him in Germany, he died. So I didn't only I'm the only designer, I believe. They let me in the design department.
Very nice of them.
And I must say, as I met all the people there and all the Wickmans, I was feeling really at home.
Yeah. So when you met with the Brown brothers, what did you talk about? Did you make decisions about the design or the products that you were going to make?
As I met the brothers Brown, it was in 1955. And at this time, as I'm always saying, what you need as a designer in your life and during your career, you need luck. And at this time, I had other ideas. I want to stay with architecture since I was working in a large architecture, together with an architectural group in Germany. Apple later Heard was the name at this time, later Apple Becker. And they are working together with Skidmore, Merrill, and Owings, and building the American consulate buildings in Germany at this time. And that was my that's what I want to do. Yeah, I want to go into the architectural things. I want to my studies in for landscape designing and such kind of things. And then a young colleague of mine, at this time in the architectural office, he said there is an announcement in a daily newspaper. There's a company Brown. Nobody knows the company Brown at this time. Brown was not known at this time.
Did the Brown brothers, did they understand the power of design? Or did you have to convince them?
It's also a long story. But anyway, I learned then the brothers Brown. They tried to find an architect for their. Erwin had wonderful ideas. They want to buildings for employees. And they want to plan a healing center for all the employees, and so a lot of architecture things. So I came to Brown as an architect after I. Okay, I give up my ideas with landscapes, planning, and all these things. And so I came as an architect in 1955. And at this time, what made me, of course, easier to make this decision was the first designs made by the school of Ulm, from mainly from Hans Güchelow, for the first radios for Brown. And as I saw these first things which was introduced in the autumn exhibition first in Düsseldorf at this time, and that makes me completely to another direction. Now I was becoming a designer.
Right. And the rest is history, as they say.
I'm curious, you know, speaking of crossing over disciplines, you know, when we were walking around the show last night, one thing you mentioned was how important it was for industrial designers to understand space and architecture and graphic design and branding. Can you talk a little bit more about that emerging role for industrial designers?
As I started my work with Brown, first as an architect, then it was clear that architecture, since we had one example at this time, that was Olivetti. Olivetti was doing one thing which was unique at this time, to combine architectural thing, graphic design, and industrial design together. Mm-hmm. And Brown was, with the help of the Ulm School at this time, trying to find a new way to do similar things. And we started with architectural things, and then it was going very fast. Yeah, in the beginning of the 50s, 56, I get the first things in the field of industrial design. This was together with Hans Güchelow from the Ulm School, with the first product design I did, with this so-called Snow White coffin. Mm-hmm. It was the first radio with this cover on with plexiglass on it, on top of it. And it also a lot of stories. So then it was starting with industrial design. Mm-hmm. Why? The brothers Brown was not able to work only with the Ulm School because it was necessary to the first radio school. They gave the people that is looking very good, but inside it's not so good. So we have to improve the technology because the outside from the design was more technical as the inside. And the process Brown was very fast thinking, okay, we need in-house a stronger combination between engineering and designer. And I get the first, I was at this time alone, yeah, but it was necessary to work closer together with the engineers to improve the technology. And that gave me a great chance, of course. And then, step by step, I could have other colleagues help me. And until the middle of the 60s, we were working only with three designers. Yeah. Step by step. So the beginning was very improvised. Yeah. We had the twilling machine next to the drawing boards. Yeah. So we developed, because it was necessary to make it clear that we need decision only by models. Yeah. You can't get decision to go process only by discussions. You need the models, and that is, you never forget your profession gives you the chance to make clear what you want to do by three-dimensional models.
Did you, in that early day, did you try and understand what the consumer likes or
no.
wants?
No. We all was together, even the Brothers Brown, Erwin Brown, that we want to make that what we like.
But let's talk about the difference between that and being human centered.
It's not possible to do the same way today anymore. That is too. But. We didn't believe that, but we want to change the world a little bit. We all, as designers, should have in your mind, we have to change the world a little bit. Now we have to change it in another way as 14 years ago, but it's necessary to change our world.
Can you talk a little bit more about that role of a young designer? And what their focal point could be moving into the future? How do they look through the designer function, but then have the ambition to move forward into changing the way that systems work? What kind of advice do you have for these young designers moving into this next world?
Yeah, this is the objective of the teachers today, I was teaching only 10 years because I was starting in 81. As at this time, Brown was still belonging to Gillette, and the chairman of the board at this time it was Lorne Wexler, coming from Gillette. Mm-hmm. I always was lucky to have some people thinking a little bit. Not Gillette thinking in this. They was believing that Brown is something special. Mm-hmm. And they allowed me to say, because it was a time in Germany where the students was against everything, especially against the industry. Mm-hmm. Yeah, that was shortly after the 16th were all
68.
Yeah. And the connection between students and industry was terrible. Mm-hmm. And we at Brown was thinking, okay, so they allowed me to have 4 days teaching in Hamburg, so I had to travel a little bit, okay. But on the other side, I could take some, but was not possible because of, you know, Apple keeps all these things very
secret.
So we did also, so nobody from normally could come into the design department. Right. But they allowed me, the students which are working with me at the school in Hamburg, they also could, I could take them in the design department. And at this time that was very important because the facilities on the on the schools they are terrible, especially model making and all these things. So, to come in to design department, which has with our possibilities in the model making and so, was for the student absolute.
Yeah, sure.
Computer, would you like some? Just a little sip of water.
So they that was a great combination between, in this case, Hamburg, the Academy of Fine Arts, but later on, Richard Zappa did the same way in Stuttgart. Mm-hmm. And this combination helps a little bit the student coming in a little more step by step away from nothing, or want to have nothing to do with the industry.
Yeah. No,
that's, they learn that there are also some possibilities.
Everyone in this room knows that that's certainly one of the commitments at ArtCenter, to work closely with industry. You said something really interesting that I wanted to ask you about. At one point you said, to design is to think. What exactly do you mean by that?
I'm saying design in the first line is a thinking process.
Right.
Because you think or have some ideas about something. You make your first scribbles on it. Yeah? And thinking as a designer means making drawings. It's the first thinking process starts in your head, but then on the drawing board. And then, very fast, I always to go into the three dimension, even by handmade models.
Do you think, you're thinking while you're drawing, what about thinking while you're on the computer? Is that the same thing or is it different?
It's a little bit different because I'm a little bit afraid. The computer can help you, but the computer can not take away your thinking. You have to think, and you have to tell the computer what he has to do. Mm-hmm. And I personally am not anymore, so I'm not anymore busy, so I don't use the computer. I still like to make my drawings by hand. And my model. I still have in my private home a model job, But the computer, it's the same thing as I had my time as an architect. The chief architect, his name was Apple, he was a Tessino. He had his studies by Tessino. And he taught me, as I was at this time, a young man, He taught me always standing behind me on my drawing board, and he said, these architects who can make their own drawings very well are suspect, because they can make by drawings too many illusions. And the same happened now with the computer, yeah? Mm-hmm. You have to say, you have to know what you want, not the computer. I never was thinking that. you always, it's not, as a good designer, you should always be aware that you are not good.
Okay. I am
sure. Always trying to be a little bit better. Yeah. It's the final decision I found was, I must say, really mostly done in a democratic way. But of course, everybody knows that the top in the earlier years, the brothers Brown, and later the chairman of the board, that they are made the last decision. They have to make the last decision. But it's as it becomes more and more an international company with the help of Gillette. Okay, Brown was very successful worldwide, especially in Japan. So the marketing influence becomes stronger and stronger. But without the help, or let me say, a lot of engineers or marketing people I have to work together with, they know that I was always protected by the top management. Even the top management here in Boston, where the Gillette headquarters were. And that helps me a lot, of course. When I said, no, this is not the way, we cannot do this, it's not Brown, then they closed their mouths.
But they did.
But that I couldn't do that because only I was Dieter Rams.
Yeah.
I only could do that because I had the support.
Was that during the time your principles that you've created? Did your coworkers and those above you follow those principles, or did you have to defend those principles?
I formulated that. I forget in the beginning of the '80s or whatever when I did that.
1976.
Keep in my mind.
Yes.
That maybe. Some of these marketing people, or some of these unbelievable people, which I don't believe that this could be the right product, that could help them to think a little bit more, that is the right way to do so. That's why I did that, but also I did it because of younger people. The students at this time, that was in the beginning where I started with teaching, so that the young people should know what I expect from them.
You were one of the first designers to call attention to the environment. So one of the principles is good design is environmentally friendly.
Yeah.
What did you mean by that? And do you think the design has changed in this way?
A little bit.
Yeah. Not so much.
Yes, not so much. We still are working very hard to protect our environment, and we still have a lot of things to do to protect our environment.
Yeah.
And on the other hand, that we do a lot to disturb our environment.
What do designers do wrong, and what should they do better about the environment?
It's not the right way to say, okay, the designers have the only responsibility for that. What I said before to you, Mark, it's maybe design schools must not teach alone students which want to be later to get a designer, a graphic designer, or industrial designer, or whatever. We should teach the politicians. Teach the entrepreneurs. We need still 13 years ago from Jonathan coming question to me what I think are the companies which really taking design honestly. And I only could tell them 13 years ago, 15 years ago, I can count it on my 10 fingers. There are only a few in the world. And that is still the case today. There are only a few. So it's a lot of things to do, not only for designers, for politicians, for entrepreneurs. And what we need are more politicians thinking design-minded. What we need are entrepreneurs like
Steve Jobs.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Entrepreneurs, which are we alone as designers, we can help with what we have learned, with our models, with our ideas. But we are not able to change the world alone.
Mm-hmm. So, how important is it for designers to be citizens, good citizens? And maybe get into politics and. Does it go the other way?
I would not say all designers should be more going now in the should be politicians. No, but we designers can influence the politicians. I learned as I get the prize from I get a prize from. How it's called the tobacco prize.
What is it?
Raymond Loeb.
I had suddenly.
I remember as I was a student, we didn't like Raymond Loeb. Raymond Loeb was styling.
Yeah.
That's terrible. Yeah. And then I get this prize, and then I had to. I had to read a little bit about Raymond Loeb. Yeah. And I learned Raymond Loeb was very well connected with Kennedy. Hmm. He was working together with Kennedy to change the world. It was a surprise for me. He also had, everybody knows that, international contacts in America. He had great connections to Russia. He was connected with, very narrow connected with Soloviev. Yeah. You know him from Exit, yes. Yeah. There was a very narrow trigger. So the world is really narrow together with only a few people, which always trying, but it's still we are on the beginning to change our world.
Have you had the chance, the opportunity to meet with German politicians or other countries to
yes,
teach them?
I had it, you know, I was president of the German Design Association, the German Ratsverband in Design. And so I had to do with some politicians, but it's amazing. In this politicians here, all every 2 years there are a new one there. And so you never get really in contact with them. I remember in Germany two names. Yeah, it was the first president of Germany, it was Theodor Heuss. He was a member of Werkbund, the German Werkbund. That's something with the Royal College, member of the Royal College in London. There was Minister of Economy at this time, Erhard. He was really two politicians. Yeah. He was thinking together with architects, how can we build a new identity for Germany, which just after the war was starting again to learn how democracy has to go and to learn to build up, after everything was nearly disturbed, a new identity. And they were very successful with the so-called Interbau, the first international architecture things in Berlin, and then also with new buildings at the World Exhibition in Brussels, mm-hmm. in Belgium. That gives the world has seen Germany in another way. And after that, I have problems to find any politicians mm-hmm. which are thinking. There was three times. Yeah, okay. This was the time was always the Stirner 2 years, and then yes. Another one comes again. It is now. The situation is a terrible situation. Mm. What I like very much is new material combinations. It's always a great possibility to combine new materials. You have always to look with open eyes what's going on. I was very strongly involved in the new technology of hard and soft combination with these materials together in a two injection way. And there is a great opportunity with new technologies. And it is one of the things where we as designers or future designers, whatever, we have always to look with very open eyes what's going on there. Mm-hmm. And you cannot find that in your own company or in the company you are working for. You have to look what is the industry, for example, what is the industry which developed the material for the new plastic materials. In Germany it's Bayer, it's BASF. So such people, what are they doing in their development departments? And there is still a great opportunity with this new technologies. And don't forget all the electronic things. We have to be careful because they are developing. The development in this era is so fast that the newest computers are in 2 years gone already. The technology, we have to look very carefully. What can we really redesign without to give up the first idea of that? It's a lot of things to do with is not so spectacular, but to redesign some things, be more and more our in our interest as designers.
I have, of course, thinking very hard about should I change something. I came to the decision by myself to change nothing. Because it was late. I never, I said, it should be written in stone, you know. It should be flexible enough, but still, I don't want to change anything today.
Before the next question, I want to follow up, because Mike, I was kind of thinking about the same thing, is we were talking about we're lifelong learners, and we're always learning. Is there something right now that you're studying? Is there something, things that might be in your shop that you could talk about? So, are there things that you're still learning today that you're studying? Are you studying specific topics? Changing? Are you changing your philosophy? There's the principles, but are you studying other things in the world?
What I'm saying, or what I have in mind to say, also tomorrow when I have to deliver.
I don't want to take away from tomorrow's address. Trying to give a little preview.
I'm not principle changing my mind. I still believe that something is unchangeable. Yeah, and that is not. That we have to look what's going on around us. The world is changing. The design has to be followed. This changing. We have to change our mind, but not basically. I believe that we must be honest, and what we have to do are honest things. And that is the basic thing of my philosophy. There is not, there are not, there is, I can say what I'm quite always doing in my life is come back to the simple things. Yeah, we don't need all unnecessary things. We have to concentrate basically on really the necessary things, on products or on houses or whatever. And there is no change. There is no basic change. This is still our main objective, to eliminate the unnecessary things, that the necessary thing comes more in the foreground. Or let me say it in another way. It's our daily products, if that are houses, our surrounding, everything what we use, we should use it like, of course, more or less rich people was using in London, their butlers. They use them when they need them, and when they don't need them, they have to stay in the background. And that has something to do with the products we have today, if that are cars, if that are our houses, or if that are our coffee maker, or whatever. They are not so important. They have to stay in the background when we don't need it, and have to be there when we need it, and have to do that what they give you with their design to the people. And this design should not give the people more as the product really can do. Then it is not honest. Right. So it's very simple. Come back to simplicity. That was also the philosophy of Steve Jobs. He get it not by himself. He get it from Leonardo da Vinci.
doing good.
I don't know any other. Today it's Apple. No question. You can be broad. It's a company from America. You grow up in America. Yeah. Started in a garage. Yeah?
Exactly.
Very simple. Very small.
Is there anybody else besides Apple?
No, it's the worldwide. And that is an example. Brown also was an example that with the help of design, you became a worldwide known. In 1955, as I came together with Brown, Brown was even in Germany not so known. But then, in 68, as Gillette was buying Brown, the president from Gillette told me he was so surprised that a company in a relatively short time became worldwide known by the help of design. He couldn't understand that, and but that was the reason why Gillette bought Brown. They want a little bit from this success for their own company, for Gillette. That what this president want, but he also was not able to work longer, 3 years, and another president comes and he has.
What happened when P&G came in?
Oh my God. I always, it was great for many employees in town. It was a great problem as Gillette by Brown in 68. And a lot of people say, okay, now we left the company. And they didn't believe that Gillette could do the same things. But I must say, Gillette really was trying until to 1995. Ready to do the best with Brown. They leave it alone. The marketing becomes stronger and stronger. That has something to do with the international business. But on the other side, the success, the worldwide success of our was not bad, Brown was well known worldwide. The business was not bad, it was always growing up every year. So the managers we are responsible had no problems with the company. These companies were fighting for good design, as Brown, as Olivetti, as they always was very successful worldwide. And now the same thing happened with Apple. Apple is one of the richest and companies in the world.
Yeah, having some troubles.
Together with design. That is nobody knows that design can help not only to make our world a little bit better, it can also help a company to be successful.
You
always have to fight with the marketing people. It's not an easy life. It's a daily fight, but hopefully you have somebody on your side who helps you. Yeah, alone, the marketing people has their qualities too. But don't forget, they are most of them are very much
better. It's sometimes difficult to win the battle with them because they are trained to argument.
It's true.
We as designers are not so trained with arguments. Our arguments are the models, are the realities we can show to the decision making. Yeah? And the marketing people are, you always have to take what they are, playing mostly with their words. So it's we shouldn't forget that we have a chance, but because we are the only ones who can show the things three dimension. Mm-hmm. I was often very frustrated, but you have to fight with yourself. Then you have to say, "Okay, start again, or whatever, or try it in another way." you must be also, you have to have a kind of, it's very difficult now to find the English word for Sturheit, yeah?
Stubborn. Okay, thank you.
You have to have a kind of Sturheit, yeah? Yeah? That helps a little bit, but it's not the only way. A lot of possibilities. You have to come to yourself. Yeah, you have to be sure that what you have in mind are the right way. But you must also be able to correct yourself. Sometimes we are. It's a lot of examples there. Look at these so-called star designers. Yeah, they believe in their things, and that is not the right way. You should always be able to correct yourself, and only also be in doubt with what you are doing. Yeah, always should think you can think again from the beginning if you can make it better. Oh, that was a lot of help gives me the working together as a young man to the delegation from Skidmore, Murray and Owings in working together with the architectural group in Germany, and I, as a young man, was one of the members of the group of the of the people from Skidmore, Merrill, and Owings. I'll never forget the most of the chief architects in the German office were Eiermanner, so-called Eiermanner. Because in Karlsruhe was Eiermann, professor for architecture, and most of the chief architects come from Eiermann. It's difficult to understand that. But they were still working in a way that they leave a lot of details to the companies who make the manufacturing of the buildings. And Skidmore, as it was doing another key, they had the dollars to do that. They made every part of these buildings, three buildings in Germany, consulate buildings, in one-to-one sections. And I never have seen a project then in the reality without any problems. But that gives me a lot of things, because the industry with a new product, no product goes into the market without it is tested, that is improved, because there are a lot of money involved, yeah, for tools and whatever. So you have to be on the sure side if you come with a new product into production. That is normal, but the architects didn't work at this time in the same way. They make one thing, and not industrial design products in more in a higher quantities. Yeah, mm-hmm. Buildings are. Yeah, that was at this time there were good 3 buildings in Germany, but normally architects have to do this one building. And so there is a difference, but anyway, the education at this time for architects was more developed as the education at this time in the 60s, 50s, as for there was no education for industrial designers. Mm-hmm. That was in the beginning system. One of the first were the school in Ulm and also in Essen, but it was in the beginning. That was not developed, you know. It was, so we could learn a lot more as young designers, beginning with design from the architect. Yeah, it was easier to answer this question. That I could say, okay, this one I'm just working on. No, I'm not working anymore on daily products. I'm still working a little bit with my furniture things, mm-hmm. but that is it's very difficult for me. I have one product which I, but it's now also collectors item. I called it the first Walkman. Mm-hmm. It was a combination of a small transistor radio in an aluminum case together with a player for, and at this time nobody knows the software was not known, but the software was the 49 disc plates, and they had a relatively short life. I use that for my English, to learn English. Yeah. Mm-hmm. But it was the first Walkman. You could walk, and the player was was made in a way that you can walk with them and had your ear. This was the first Walkman. Mm-hmm. Yeah. But the life was very short, and the production was not a great quantity which was produced. That is because now it is really a collector's game, and people are playing, are willing to pay a lot of money for that. Mm-hmm. Yeah. First thinking then, for me, for myself, it's my first sketches. Thinking is not to write down something. Sometimes I write down some words to remember me and for some material. But mainly are sketches, drawings. And I could make these drawings by hand in a way that because I wasn't able to do that by myself at that, so that somebody in the model shop could do it from my hand sketches. Yeah, it was without any. It was always one to one, and that is my process. But it is not. It's not done by have an idea and have this idea now on your sketch. It is a long way to get this idea through the process that it is be manufacturable, and it is goes to all the decision-making processes. So the whole process together is a different and long way. And that goes back that you have to find a company which is able to do this process. Yeah? And that makes the world so narrow. Because that comes to that, if you get these questions, which companies are really taking design serious, you only can mention only few worldwide. Because we alone as designers, it's not enough you have ideas and are able to make a sketch of these ideas. You have to find a way how you get this idea to the whole process, the manufacturing process, to the process, money plays a great role. If you have an idea where you need tools to make the things, which the tools or the manufacturing equipments today for making products in a mass production way, this manufacturing tools or equipments are so expensive today that it plays a great role to make a decision, a go or not go decision.
A mentor is the one thing I must say, quite frankly, I have not always had a mentor. When I say a mentor, okay, I was lucky to find on my way some entrepreneurs who were thinking in the same way and also was able to do these things, yeah, to manufacture things. That is, it was a great risk for the for Erwin Braun, for the Braun process at this time, to say, no, we make that in this way. Nobody could him say, okay, you will be successful on it. Now, I mentioned the first design I did together with Hans Güchelow, with this radio becomes the nickname Snow White Coffin. Yeah. Even the engineers at this time, he was living in a total other environment privately. They only was, at this time the technicians like to have a brandy or something like that. That they would, and I often had to spend some
bottle of brandy.
we discussed a little bit about this. And then we come a little, a kind of friendship. But they didn't believe that somebody should buy these things. That was a problem, really. And that was a great risk of entrepreneurs at this time to say, ever even Apple, as they began in a garage, to do them, it was, nobody could tell them that after some years, they are the successful company in the world. Yeah. So it is, life is risk. And design is also life, and is also risk.
Okay. Folks, it's been wonderful. I don't want you to leave without my thanking the extraordinary Office of Alumni Relations, Christine Baum, the director, for putting on this event today. And once again, I know I speak for all of you when I say this has been an extraordinary pleasure and privilege to spend time with Dieter Rams. Thank you very much.